Hey, I'm John McCutcheon, a software engineer working on the DART virtual machine. In this talk, I'm going to introduce the DART Observatory, a powerful tool for profiling and analyzing DART applications. Finally, I will explain how to use the CPU profiler to guide you while optimizing DART code. This talk is aimed at an intermediate DART programmer who wants to make her programs fly. Observatory is a powerful tool for analyzing and profiling running DART programs. It's a new type of tool which gives you an always live, hyperlinked view into the running state of your program. Presently, Observatory consists of six tools. The first is View and Evaluate. You can view any object inside the VM, an isolate, a library, a class, or in any instance of a class. You can also evaluate expressions in the context of these objects, including expressions that modify the object that you're looking at. There's code coverage, which you can view alongside the source directly in Observatory. The CPU profiler is always on, always sampling the running program, collecting statistics about where it's executing. The allocation profile collects statistics for each class, allowing you to figure out how many instances your program allocates of each one. Now, we can give you a stack trace at any time, and this is a snapshot of the call stack, including local stack variables, which you can view and manipulate even after the program has continued running. And if you're interested, you can even visualize the heap. Code coverage is an important tool when testing your program. That is, if there are code paths that are never executed by your tests, you don't really know if those code paths are correct or not. Now, Observatory gives you up-to-date code coverage on demand. Now, code coverage is displayed next to your program source lines. A green box indicates that the code is executable and has executed, whereas a red box indicates that the code is executable but hasn't executed. And this is not a good thing. If you see a lot of red boxes after you've run your test suite, you don't have the coverage necessary to really know for certain that your program is correct. Now, lines without a green or red box are not executable. Typically, these are comments or other white space inside your program. Remember, code coverage can be refreshed on demand, so even in the middle of running your test suite, you can go ahead and just take a peek and see how much coverage you've got already. Observatory's allocation profile gives you live, up-to-date statistics about what type of objects your program is allocating. The allocation profile displays information about both old and new space, and this information is displayed the same for each, so we're just going to focus on new space. So you can see on the slide we have a pie chart showing how much of the space is used and how much of it is free. And alongside the pie chart, we have a table of statistics about collections that have occurred in this space. The total number of collections that have occurred since the program started, the average time each collection took, that's the amount of time that your program is paused for when we're doing a GC pause, and the cumulative time that all of the GCs in this space has taken out of your program's execution time. Now, below the pie chart is a table showing for each class how many instances your program is allocated, how many are alive in the moment, and how many of them have survived the last GC. Remember, in the allocation profiler, you can go ahead and manually trigger a GC, so you can be certain that you're looking at up-to-date memory usage information. Reducing the number of allocations your program performs can have a big impact on performance, because by allocating fewer objects, you're going to incur shorter and less frequent GC pauses, which is always good for your program's performance. Now, let's take a quick look at an Observatory CPU profile capture of a game that uses the popular 2D physics library Box2D. Now, DART's profiler aggregates samples into buckets that we call tags, and the root of this tree is the default tag that is set automatically when your program begins executing. Now, if we expanded the default tag, and we see the VM tags. And the VM tags are categories of execution that the VM sets while your program is running. So sometimes the VM has to transition over and compile some functions that have never been executed before, and so you'll see the compile tags show up. But we can see from this profile that 95% of the time, the script tag is set. And that's good, because the script tag is set when we're actually executing DART code. Now, below script, we see that the next highest tag is 3%, and that's GC new space. So right away, we can see that this program is spending 95% of its time executing and only 3% of its time garbage collecting new space. And they're spending little time elsewhere. Now, expanding script shows us the hot functions in Box2D. We see at the top solve velocity constraints, solve position constraints, sine and cos. Now, the seven functions highlighted on the slide account for more than 40% of all CPU time used. These are some pretty hot functions. But sometimes you're going to look at a profile and there won't be any hot functions, and we call this a flat profile. Now, in this case, you can use custom tags to help aggregate and reveal where you're spending time. Now, if we want to see who called solve velocity constraints, we can expand its node and we can see that 100% of the time it is called from island.solve. And further, if we want to see who called island.solve, we can expand its node and we can see that 100% of the time it's called from world.solve. So we can already see that Box Studio is spending most of its time solving the world's velocity and position constraints. And if your game is suffering from a performance problem, looking at the constraints you use is the obvious next step. With only a few clicks, we've been able to gain a high-level understanding of how the program is running inside the VM and what functions are hot. Now that we've done a quick overview, let's take a slightly deeper look at the data displayed by the profiler. The Observatory profiler is structured as a tree, rooted with the categories of execution, which we call tags, followed by functions. Now you can configure how the tree is displayed, putting VM tags before user tags, or the other way around, or you can hide either set of tags if you're not interested. Now, above the profile tree, you'll notice a summary is displayed. In this case, the samples were collected over 2 minutes and 11 seconds of wall clock time. We collected 120,000 samples at 1,000 hertz. This is also where you configure how the tags are displayed. Below the summary, you'll see the profiler tree. Now, each row in the tree is either a tag or a function whose name is displayed in the center of the tree. For each tag or function, there's two numbers associated with it. The first number displayed to the left of the name is the percentage of its parent's node, and the second number displayed on the right of the table is the global exclusive CPU usage. Here, we've expanded the default tag and the script tag, and you can see that solve velocity constraints is 8.92% of all script execution and 8.6% of global CPU usage. Now, because the script tag is so close to 100% of the program's execution time, these two numbers are really close. Otherwise, there might be a larger discrepancy between the two. This screenshot shows the call tree expanded to show more of the call chain to solve velocity constraints. Note that the exclusive column for the callers is close to 0%. Intuitively, this makes sense because these functions do very little work themselves other than call to other functions that do the real work, all the way up to solve velocity constraints, which is a hot function in this program. Now, optimizing programs is an art and a science. The science is understanding exactly what your profiler is measuring, which we just covered. The art is making effective optimizations, which often requires intuition about your own program and the system it is running on. Now let's talk about the cycle of optimization in general. The cycle begins with measuring using your profiler. And at first, you're measuring to identify the hotspots in your program. These hotspots are the functions that you're spending a lot of time in or the tags that you're spending a lot of time in. Now, once you've identified the hotspot, you want to create a representative benchmark. This benchmark executes the hotspot with typical inputs. Now, technically, this step is optional, but it can really help with your iteration times if you have a canned program that exercises the slow path of your program. Now, using this representative benchmark, measure again with a profiler. This is going to give you a baseline to measure your optimizations against. Without a good baseline, you can't tell if the changes you've made things better or worse. So with your baseline, you're ready to optimize. This is where your own intuition comes into play. Your goal is to minimize the amount of time in the hotspots, and there are many different approaches here. You can experiment with reducing the amount of work done, caching results, or using different algorithms entirely. Now that you've made a change that you think will speed your program up, prove it by measuring again and comparing with your baseline. And when that way you can say definitively that you've made your program 5% faster, 10% faster, or it's had no effect at all. You repeat this cycle until you're happy with the performance of your program. Before I go, I'd like to leave you with a couple tips on optimizing your Dart programs. In the profiler tree, optimized Dart functions are prefixed with an asterisk. Now, if your hot functions aren't optimized, you've got a problem. You're probably triggering excessive de-optimizations or prohibiting optimizations from occurring in the first place. And you need to understand why that is, because optimized code executes much faster than unoptimized code, and so you want to make sure that your hot functions can and are staying optimized. Now, you can get a high-level idea of how your program is running simply by looking at the VM tags, and there are certain patterns that you should come to expect. For applications which do lots of computation, you should see script very high up there. Now, you're probably allocating too much if GC is high, in which case, hop over to the allocation profiler to help understand what you're allocating so you can minimize that. Now, applications that do lots of file and network I.O. should have a hot native tag because the actual I.O. is done by calling out to the operating system. So for server applications, you want to see a hot native tag. I'm John McCutcheon, and you just learned about Observatory and the Dart CPU Profiler. You can learn more about Dart and Observatory by following the links on the slide. Thanks for watching.